So let us continue and use the call to worship that is written. Come, let us celebrate the forgiving, reconciling love of God.
Those who have so far away, now have been welcomed home.
Know that God's love is lavished upon you forever.
We rejoice at the news of forgiveness and hope. Come, let us celebrate and praise the God of love.
With that, please stand as you are able and join us in song.
Thank you.
faith. Share that grace with the world. Open our eyes, open our ears, open our hearts to your presence, and help us to feel you and to experience your grace. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Imagine what it's like when you're found.
you've been lost and you are found. Imagine how wonderful that feels. That's kind of what this scripture is about today. It's about God loving us and finding us, and that we never feel scared again. Now, if you feel scared, God's with us, and your parents will find you. But if you don't feel scared, and if you feel like you're home, and if you feel like you're connected, then that's what it's like. Is you are with God, and you don't feel scared, and you know you're loved, and you know everything's going to be all right. So that's what the end of the scripture is about. So, and they actually throw a party because the lost one is found. So it's kind of a neat story. This is, in the scripture, it's called The Prodigal Son. Sometimes it's called The Story of the Two Lost Sons. You'll hear more about it. And it's really about how God loves us and always finds us. That God knows where we are. Just like my parents knew where I was in the grocery store. I just didn't know where they were. God always knows where we are. And God always keeps us safe. And that's what this is about. That God always knows where we are. And we can always feel safe in God's presence. So, God knows. All right. Let's say a prayer. Repeat after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for finding us.
Thank you for finding us.
Help us to remember.
Help us to remember.
How much you love us.
How much you love us.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much.
Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Our second reading is Luke 15, verses 11 through 32. Then Jesus said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the wealth that will belong to me.' So he divided his assets between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant region. And there he squandered his wealth in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that region, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that region, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with joy, with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet, and get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called out one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, 'Your brother has come home, and your father has killed the fat calf because he has got him back safe and sound.' Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who has devoured your assets with prostitutes, you have killed the fattened calf for him. Then the father said to him, Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead, and his has come to life. He was lost and has been found. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The parable for today builds on the two parables from last week. Last week it was the lost coin and the lost sheep, and today's parable, usually called the prodigal son, but could easily be called the parable of the two lost sons, and you've probably heard that before. We often focus on the younger son, the one who goes wild and lives crazy in a faraway land, then, as our translation says in today's reading, and he came to his senses. But I like one of the old translations that says, he came back to himself, his true self. He returned to the image of God that he was meant to be. He returned to himself. And he returned home asking for forgiveness. And we know the rest of the story, accepted love, party, all that kind of stuff. This son was clearly lost, and is named so by the father in the last verses, was lost and is now found and we celebrate. But the truth is, in the story, both of the sons were lost for a time. At the beginning of the story, both of the sons are lost. At the end of the story, we find out that the elder brother was bitter and jealous and angry and resentful. And he wanted to withhold everything from his brother, and he was angry with his father because the father was generous and joyful. And at the very end of this parable, we don't know what happens to the oldest son, as often happens in the Gospel of Luke. The parable is left open. Jesus leaves the parable open-ended. So we're not sure what happens to the older son, whether he remains lost, or if he too might be found and rejoice in that celebration, might be found by the overwhelming, unconditional, amazing, abundant love of the Father in the story. That love of the Father, you know, that phenomenal love of God, is the central point of these stories, and this story particularly, this familiar parable. God loves. That's what it's all about. God forgives, God redeems, God accepts, God restores, God loves. That's what it's all about. God welcomes home those who have gone astray. God continues to love those who haven't gone astray. God loves, pure and simple, and God rejoices over every child of God, God's beloved children. God rejoices over every single one. That's the point of the story, the point of the gospel. In the parable, we hear about the party thrown for the younger son, but it's also clear that the father loves the elder son as well and wants for the best for the elder son. God sees the gifts of that older son and recognizes everything I have is yours. And God wants what is best for that elder son, just like God wants what is best for that, or the father wants what is best for that younger son. In fact, God wants joy for all of God's children. God wants joy for this elder son, joy that is denying himself. It is not being denied by anybody but himself. He could jump in and celebrate as well. Remember, context of the story, Jesus first tells this story in answer to the Pharisees, who were objecting to Jesus welcoming and dining with sinners. Objecting to Jesus celebrating with sinners and being with those that they considered less than. We can see the parallels between the Pharisees and the elder brother. That parallel was was drawn intentionally by Jesus. But both of them, the Pharisees and the elder brother, both saw themselves as superior. Both resented the favorable treatment of being given to the ones that they deemed unworthy, that they thought were not deserving. Sometimes the relationship between Jesus and the Pharisees in the Bible, sometimes it is seen as adversarial. And so we, in our day, think of the Pharisees as the enemy. But this is only because the Pharisees made it so, or tried to make it so. Jesus' perspective is not adversarial. Jesus wants what is best for the Pharisees. Jesus' perspective is more in line with the father in the story, who loved both sons and wanted what is best for everyone. Jesus wanted the best for the Pharisees. He wanted them to know God's grace and joy. They had sort of forgotten some of the joy of being in God's presence by being stuck in the rules of obedience to the religion of the day. So Jesus tried to help them see that love in new ways, and also see that love doesn't have any limits, that God's love is without bounds. There's more than enough to go around. There is plenty of room for all of the celebrations of all people in the kingdom of God. Jesus was trying to show them this. The Father wanted the elder son to come into the party and to rejoice with them together, to celebrate and be part of the reunion and the homecoming. The Pharisees couldn't see that. The elder son in the story, we don't know what happened. It's left open-ended. So for us, where do we end up? Where do we come out in this story? Are we inside the partygoers? Are we outside pouting about what's unfair and how unfair it seems that these are allowed something that perhaps we thought was due to us? Arguing about who is invited in. Where do we fall in the story? Are we setting up the fences and the walls, or are we building the bridges and the bandstands and throwing the party? Are we inviting people into the presence of God, or are we in any way limiting and helping to keep people out of God's presence? God has invited everyone in. God says, rejoice with me. God wants everybody at the party. Where do we fall in that line? I had a thought while I was thinking about this sermon, and a rewrite of the sermon perhaps. What would happen if, to the parable, if there had been a third child along, the two sons that went astray? What if there had been a son or a daughter who was not lost? What would that child have done? A child who understood the parent's love, a child who shared that parent's love. What would the parable look like then? Well, of course, there was such a child. Jesus Christ is the child of God who models for us how to be like the Father, how to do what the Father does and rejoice as the Father's love is shared, how to welcome the lost, how to rejoice with the found, how to celebrate the gifts of God to all the people of God. Jesus is the child of God who shows us how we should be living. What would Jesus do in this parable of the lost son and the loving father? What would Jesus have done along the line? And by implication, what is it we should be doing as beloved children of God? I imagine, Jesus would have tried to talk the younger son into not leaving in the first place. I think Jesus might, probably would have gone out looking for the younger son during that time, trying to bring him home to please the Father. Jesus would certainly join the Father in that race down the road to greet and welcome the prodigal home. Jesus would help throw the party, decidedly, and will probably be the happiest person there, the happiest child of God there. Jesus would have called that hardworking elder brother in and talked. talked and said, come to the party, and tried to encourage that elder brother to see where the Father's love falls. And Jesus would have made sure that everyone there knew that they were loved, that they were welcome, that they were special, that they were God's other children. Jesus would have been there. That's our call, to do the same, to be the child of God who understands God's love and shares that love everywhere we go, with everyone possible. That's our call, to be that child of God who follows God's path. Why do you think that the Pharisees were upset? Why were they mad at Jesus for welcoming sinners? Or jealous of Jesus for being popular? Perhaps that was what was going on. Why were they upset? Why was the older brother angry that his father threw the party for the younger brother? He probably thought he would lose something. It's as if they were afraid there wasn't enough to go around. It's as if they were afraid that they would lose something, that something would be taken from them. But that's not the case. The son lost nothing because the father welcomed the brother home. It all belonged to the elder son. The Pharisees lost nothing because of God's love and because Jesus welcomed everyone. We lose nothing if we share God's love freely and fully. In fact, we gain exponentially as we share God's love. We gain abundantly all the love that we share by God's grace. As we share God's love, love just grows and grows. As we share God's love, so also do we grow and grow and become better and better every day. So, if one thing is clear in the parables of the last week and this week, it is the parables of the lost and the found. It is that God invites us to celebrate and rejoice and share love. That is absolutely obvious. God says, come, celebrate with me, rejoice with me. God welcomes everyone. God wants everyone to be there. God blesses, affirms, gifts, and calls every single one. God loves everyone. You are the one whom God adores. You are the one whom God searches out and runs to welcome home. You are the one for whom Jesus died. You are the one who was invited into eternal life with God forever. God rejoices over you, each of you, all of us. God celebrates you. God is always with you. That's what we always remember. God loves you. So rejoice and be glad, as the parable says. Celebrate with God, for God welcomes all of us home in God's grace. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
receive, we will all respond to hear our prayer. We'll keep praying and close with the Lord's Prayer at the end. And let us pray together. Gracious, loving God, we do thank you for the love you bring us, for the ways that you bless us. We thank you for mercy each day and gifts of joy every moment. We thank you for this community of faith and for these friends among us and for the ways that you bless us. Quiet our fears and inspire our joy that we may live lives of celebration and service, knowing your presence and your provision beyond what we need or even imagine. Help us to remember the ways that you call us and the ways that you bless us and the ways that we may share all that you have given us. Awaken in us a recognition of your blessing and bounty and lift our hearts to overflowing joy. Open our eyes to your mercy and beauty each day, to your presence among us, to the ways we are able to respond to your love. We pray for particular people and particular needs and particular issues in our world today. We pray your grace, your presence. We pray for those who are sick, those who are hospitalized or homebound or in nursing homes, those who are grieving loss. We pray for people who suffer in various parts of the world and for the challenges that are being faced. We pray for our servicemen and women. We pray for first responders and ask your prayer to keep them safe. We pray for those who are hungry or homeless or in need and those who are searching for you. Help us to be the home where all may find you, where we may share your love in the world. As school is forming and teachers are going back to school and graduates and college students are going off to their new homes, we ask your blessing. We ask your guidance, your peace, and your grace. Help us as we have spoken and unspoken prayers, that you may hear all that we are saying, that we may respond with your grace, to your grace. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen. Your prayers.
Diagnosis and treatment, particularly I lift to you, as Anna McClain, Brenda Jones, who's having surgery Friday, and other members of the congregation and those we know and love who have a battle with this illness. Lord, in your mercy.
Prayers for my job and all essential workers. We are really still struggling out there. We really need people and able bodies and good hearts to help us. Just ask for that. Lord, in your mercy.
Gracious God, we know there are other needs that we may not be able to express. We know that there are concerns. We also know that there are joys that we want to celebrate. We ask your blessing, your inspiration, and how we may be able to share your love in the world and expand your kingdom and your grace. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray as we now pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
stand as you're able and join us in song as we conclude today's service.
Be with you now and evermore. Amen.